Good morning. We begin with breaking news in Sydney. Nearly 4 weeks after the Perrottet government was voted out of power in New South Wales, the Liberals have a new leader, former Attorney General Mark Speakman. Damien Ryan is live for us. Damo, talk us through what's happened there this morning.
Well, Soph, it was certainly a job no one really wanted. Well, they certainly weren't rushing to put their hand up, and it has taken 1 month after the coalition's thumping election loss for them to stand up and make some decisions. Well, in the end, it was the former Attorney General Mark Speakman who's been elected as the new Liberal leader. It was a two-horse race, of course. The former Planning Minister Anthony Roberts was one of the first to put up his hand and say, I want to be the leader. Well, it didn't end up that way. The vote was 22-13, and the party official, the party whip, just made this announcement official just a short time ago.
That the Honourable Mark Speakman has been elected leader of the Liberal Party here in New South Wales. I can also confirm that Damien Tudorhope was elected leader in the Legislative Council. Also, Natalie Waugh was elected deputy leader in the Legislative Council. I was elected whip in the Legislative Assembly, and Chris Rath was elected the whip in the Legislative Council. I'm pleased that these results, it was a very strong result for Leader Mark Speakman, and obviously the leader will come into a press conference in due course.
Mark Speakman is a 63-year-old, of course, the member of Cronulla, a major Sharks fan, and in fact, this will probably rule out any afterthought of him maybe lining up to go federal and seek Scott Morrison's seat of the seat of Cook. So at the moment, he now looks like he's a long-term proposition. Well, he'll hope so. Dominic Perrottet was present for the meeting where, of course, he officially tendered his resignation as the Liberal leader. Sophie?
Damo, thank you. The man who helped cover up the murder of his stepdaughter, Kyesha Whippet, has been released from jail. 43-year-old Robert Smith has spent the past 12 years behind bars, but will now serve the remainder of his 16-year sentence in the community. He pled guilty to the charges of manslaughter in Western Sydney in 2011, helping his partner, Christy Abraham, who also remains behind bars. Rupert Murdoch's eldest son, Lachlan, has dropped his defamation proceedings against Australian news publisher Crikey. It was over an article which he claimed referred to his family as unindicted co-conspirators in the US Capitol riots. Murdoch's lawyer has released a statement saying they no longer wish to allow Crikey to use the case to facilitate a marketing campaign to boost subscribers. There's a development in the debate over the proposed Indigenous voice to Parliament, with the federal government releasing highly anticipated legal advice. Federal politics reporter Ashley Wick is live for us in Canberra. Ash, what does it say?
Well, this is the first time we have seen the Solicitor General's advice, Sophie. It basically says the proposed voice to Parliament will not impede decision-making here in Canberra. The opposition has been calling on the government to release these documents. Peter Dutton, he's been raising concerns over the scope and power of the voice. One of the opposition's main arguments against the Indigenous advisory body is that it could expose the government to legal challenges. However, Solicitor General Stephen Donoghue has dismissed the suggestion it would clog up the courts. He holds the opinion the government isn't required to consult with the voice prior to developing any policy or making any decision. He adds that it will actually enhance Australia's system of government. The Prime Minister has been at a childcare centre in Bankstown this morning. That's in Sydney's southwest. He has spoken about the release of this advice. Now, it's not the original document that was given to Cabinet, but an updated version dated a few days ago.
This puts to bed the absolute nonsense of Peter Dutton and Barnaby Joyce and all the nonsense that they've carried on with, saying that somehow recognising Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people in our constitution will lead to Anzac Day being abolished. It is complete nonsense. They are just determined to play politics with this.
This advice is important, but it's disappointing it's only a couple of days old and isn't the full advice that was received by the government.
Now, Australians will have their say on the proposal when a referendum is held later this year. Sophie?
Ash, thanks for the update. All charges against actor Alec Baldwin over the shooting of cinema photographer Helena Hutchins on the set of Rust in 2021 will be dropped. Details from US correspondent Alison Petrusky.
Well, 2 weeks ahead of the scheduled trial, Alec Baldwin's lawyers have confirmed that the two counts of involuntary manslaughter against him will be dropped. In a statement, they said, "We are pleased with the decision to dismiss the case against Alec Baldwin, and we encourage a proper investigation into the facts and circumstances of this tragic accident." The charges were over the fatal shooting of cinematographer Helena Hutchins on the set of Rust in 2021. Baldwin was holding the gun, but he has always maintained that he did not pull the trigger. This stunning reversal comes after a series of missteps from the prosecution. In February, charges against Baldwin were downgraded, and in March, the Santa Fe district attorney stepped down from the case and appointed a new special prosecutor.
The new person that came on maybe looked at this evidence and said, there is not enough evidence here where we can get a verdict, a conviction, at trial.
Now, Alec Baldwin is in Montana. He's due to resume filming Rust there tomorrow. Baldwin has said in the past that this tragedy has taken a toll on his career and he was close to quitting the film business. But his legal woes are certainly not over. There are still five other civil cases pending as a result of this tragic shooting.
Now to a remarkable story out of WA, where a mother and her teenage son have escaped injury after their light plane slammed into the ocean just north of Fremantle. Jack Hahn joins us now from Leighton Beach, where it happened. Jack, how did it all unfold?
Well, Sophie, as we join you at this hour, the aircraft is still submerged 50 metres off the shore of Leighton Beach. Western Australian police have been here all morning putting together a plan to extract the plane. Now, this all unfolded at about 5 o'clock yesterday afternoon when a Piper Cherokee aircraft was flying over Perth's western suburbs and suffered an engine failure. This could not have happened at a worse time for the aeroplane. It was at a flight level of 1,500 feet. That's about 400 metres off the ground, giving it 2 minutes of gliding time. But the closest airport was 5 minutes away. So the pilot had two options: to either land the aircraft on the very busy Swan River or ditch it off the coast of Perth. She went with the second option, and it was a good one, lining up the aircraft on approach, flaring the aeroplane and making a textbook emergency landing. She was able to swim to the shore and cleared of any medical injury. She spoke to the Nine Network on the Today Show exclusively earlier.
It happened very, very quickly, and I really didn't have time to do anything other than make sure I could get down safely. And I actually wanted to land on the beach, and I looked down and there was people all over the beach. I was just like, oh wow, okay, yep, that's not going to be good. No. So I thought I'll just land as close to the beach as I can without hitting anybody so we can get out and swim ashore.
Now, why did the aeroplane's engine cut out? We know it had enough fuel. We know that it passed all of its checks when it departed an outback airport about 1,000 k's north of Perth. So all of that will now form a critical part of the investigation, Sophie.
They certainly have a tale to tell. Jack, thank you.